So anyway, oh my gosh, look, will we bring the tube tops back? I don't think so. But remember them? They were like this, really stretchies, and they had the like rivlets. Oh my gosh, you girls were awful. I was never really that way, but oh, what was I gonna say? I was gonna talk of business. Oh my gosh, I'm deep into it. I have the bookstore. I guess I've gone back many years. I'm back to bookstore inventory. Oh my gosh, I'm not happy with Amazon. I'm not happy with eBay. I'm not happy with any of you. You made it really difficult still. It's still not an easy template find. It's for bulk inventory. Oh my gosh, it's not easy. So it's not great. For $40, they want $40 a month, and I'm like, well, what am I getting for my $40? It looks like it's just nothing. I'm just getting to upload a whole bunch of items. I'm not getting anything back, you know, software-wise. I'm not getting anything back, like, on receive with the software. And it's just like, what's the deal? I just get an Excel sheet, and it's a template, and it's blank, and it's like good riddance to all of the instructions that are like 20 pages long. And I have to go through all these ISBN codes, and at the same moment have the hassle of reading the instructions on being a seller. So it's not a joy. It's not a joy. They haven't done a great job of it. And so I imagine there is an occupation. They've created a new occupation for someone. So now we have to hire somebody to kind of understand, you know, the instructions. So, yeah, it's the occupation builder world, isn't it? Another occupation, you know, make it so hassle-y, you know. So I've got the little Excel sheet, and I can't use your macro, so forget that. But I have hundreds and hundreds of books, and I believe I'm going to 1,000 pretty quickly. And then after that, I don't know. I think I need a break. I found many beautiful illustrations, and I kind of want to reprint them and turn them into lithographs on the wall prints. Yeah, something like that. Very rare old prints. So I'm very excited for this. And actually, that's more of a business than the selling of the books. But I don't have the human help for that one, so that'll be a back burner, I guess so. And oh my gosh, I have so many wonderful topics. I have the, like, you want to learn Spanish, I've got Spanish, and I'm like, well, what am I gonna do? You know, I've got you know, training a horse. I've got a horses and horses and horse books, and I've got country western music songs, like the scores, and I have all of these how to landscape again and again and again and again. So I am pretty much Barnes, the Barnes and Noble of me, the Barnes. I'm the Barnes' name, so it's kind of interesting to be the Barnes' name, and I'm here again surrounded by the books. I guess they can never leave me. So here I am with everything, every publishing that's just had to be, you know. And in a way, I am... Oh, there's so many moments in my life. I'm just like, just can't you just take everything out of this garage and burn it? You know, I just hate it. I hate all of these items. And yet, in another token, what of the print? You know, what of the rainforest that was felled? You know, for many of these books, the rainforest. You know, just for this little book, Gardening with Color. You know what I'm saying? You know, how rude to throw the book away, how rude, you know, to burn it, how absolutely rude and dishevelment of me as a human. So, So in all my big wealth here, I'm wondering about wealth, I'm wondering about who is the richest on the block, you know. And is it me? I mean, I invented perpetual motion. It's supposed to be me. Is there somebody richer on the block? You know, if there's somebody richer on the block, let me know. Yeah, it's a funny game. Terrariums and miniature gardens. Oh my gosh, I have so much happiness, except yesterday I did spill coffee. I spilled coffee on the, on one rare, book, and then it, oh my gosh, it pretended it did not feel the coffee. So it was great. Very, very beautiful book. I have a lot of rare books. I have a lot of antiquarian. I'm not really sure where antiquarian starts. I'll find out. I believe antiquarian is way back, like before 1900, 100 years or more. I believe rare is even before antiquarian. So I'm a little confused on when I can state antiquarian, because. Yeah, these are really old and ancient and yellowing and terrible, and my eyes, I'm worried about my eyesight, you know, because this is a job of just eyesight all the time. You know, you gotta get to know all of your publishers, you get to know everything, and then yet, oh my gosh, yeah. And I don't want to part with some of them. You know, some of them are very beautiful. Some are very beautiful. I have a lot of illustrative, beautiful artworks. I don't want to part with. You know, if anything, I want them reproduced. So how? That's my big deal. It's how to reproduce those. You know. Yeah, I mean, absolutely phenomenal. When I think about, like, what do we call it? A lot of children's illustrations and children's illustrators. I've seen such crud, you know, in recent times, and then I've seen such greatness in the prior times. So it's almost like, I hate to say it, but when you go back to the rich and the poor, we've gallied ourselves into such a situation that it's like when you go rich and then you have the poor, you have a lot of good time on your hands to illustrate, make your children's books amazing. When you have the middle class doing the artwork, oh, this is going to be something. Yeah, when you have the middle class doing the artwork, it's pitied out as a billing status. You know, it's pitied out as, I really don't have the total time. If you're rich enough, you have the total time. Do you understand? If you're rich enough, you have the total time to poet. If you're rich enough, you have the total time to draw, to illustrate. If you are rich enough, if you're middle class, I'm sorry, it's just lack. You know it. It's lack, it's fast, it's inarticulate. It's indecisive. It's just a had to. It's for money. So now what? So now I'm saying only the rich can illustrate. Only the rich can paint. Only the rich can draw. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because when you start to put, who are they? I'm in a hurry. I'm busy. When you start to put them in front of the canvas, we've ruined it. We have ruined art. We have ruined poetry. We have ruined writing. When you put I am in a hurry in front of any of this, in photography. When you put, I am in a hurry, I'm busy, I have to make money to pay the bills, in front, when you put that in front, you destroy the truth of beautiful, of craftsmanship, of artisan, of absolutely total concentration and focus. I do not believe the middle class can have absolute total concentration and focus. I just don't think so. And then somebody will say, well, what about the poor poverty artists? They're so amazing. The poorest poverty artists. Well, maybe if they're given a government stipend, you know, every month, and they just know they get that for like the next 10 years or something. Or maybe they're so retired that they're on their Social Security. Maybe then they can paint. But before that time, no. I just think it's garbage. I think it's coming from a garbage substantialism of that person. I don't think they can put their total energy into it. I mean, you saw my last painting. It was crud. Absolute crud. Because you've all put me in this state of, she didn't invent perpetual motion. So, because you put me in that state of negligence, I'm giving out a terrible feed. You don't understand? So I'm giving out a terrible feed to society. Absolutely awful. I demand that I am a great poet. I demand that I am a great artist. I demand, do you understand, that I'm a great singer. Based upon my idea formations of the past, my idea collections and knowledge, my givings to society. All of that is a value, all of that is a worth. All right, so hoo-ha. Hoo-ha. I have country western scores. Isn't that funny? I don't even like country western music. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Broadway. I have Broadway scores. How did I end up with Broadway scores? My mother. What a nut. Anyway. Back to the collections. Yeah, I think I've got over 1,000 books. I'm up to 200 in my inventory creation. But yeah, I think I have over 1,000. Could be more. And so, yeah, I'm busy. I guess so. I guess that's what you all want, the state across my face, middle class. Middle class, I'm busy. Middle class, or poverty stricken, I'm busy. Is that what you want? The slate across my face? That nothing, I have nothing of value I've ever given. Not one thing of value I've ever given to society. I don't know. What a garbage group. What a garbage group. My particular family. What a garbage group. Oh, did I say my particular family? I didn't actually mean that. I just meant people who try are in my particular family realm to control. To control. What was it I was stating and seeing recently? To control me as if I am an algebraic formulation, an arithmetic, a geometric, or an algebraic. They want to control me as if I am an arithmetic formation. When you get into philosophy and further into the states of man in talk and discussion, geometry itself is only a middle. Algebra is the third. Arithmetic is the first. Now, trying to control me within arithmetic and denounce my particular standing through geometry on into algebra, that's a crime. It's an absolute crime. Yeah, we have an algebraic form. possible to reach in our brain. If you're not able to reach that in your brain, then that's just the way you go. That's a really, really interesting concept, you know, where you meet yourself with mathematics. Certain people can only meet themselves arithmetically. Now, when I say arithmetically, I mean here, now. Counting everything. Counting everything as their factual database of inputs. That requirement. The counting of everything. He gave him so much money. She gave her a flower. He has a green car. These are arithmetic types of personalities. When you go further, and allocations to each of those, like a green car costs. When you go further into the personality, you can go deeper. And is it a personality? Is it just a brain, what the brain is able to achieve? If you go into the geometric state of the person, past algebra, past arithmetic, when you go past arithmetic, when you go past that and you're looking at geometry specifically, everything is a little bit different, isn't it? Because now you have declaration status. When you're looking at that particular mind increase, I'll say it's a mind increase, all right? You're looking at an absolute jurisdiction status. So you can see an isosceles situation. You can see, do you understand? You can actually see a symbol of formation. Like this event, that event, and that event. So you can actually count three things together and make a symbolization of formation. So that is a different mind. That's a step up, but it's still the data. It's still gleaned off the original arithmetic brain. So it's still just that state. Now, when you go further, this is all from my old books I was reading, glimpsing through. Yeah, these old books. Oh my gosh. Yeah, this is in there. You know what I'm saying? A lot of philosophies are living in the old books. Now, so when we're going through further on, you've had that formation. Let's say you can make the well, he has this, this one has this, this one has this, and so you're now able to actually have a formation of a square or a formation of a circle or a formation of a triangle. So you have that type of mind. So that's great, you know. So it gives you one up. Now, particularly, they said that that's more of an active mind, a very active person. Now, if you go into further on to the algebraic mind, is something quite interesting. Because the algebraic mind is dealing with, you have to go straight into it, the XYZ factor. You're dealing with, you know, the three-dimensional. So it's not just algebra, first, second, and third. It starts to take your brain somewhere else. You start to go, well, there are other facets. So when you are talking to a human being, you know, you can see them go, again and again, and that's all they can do, you know. And so you're dealing with that type of brain, and you're like, well... But then there are the other facets, you know. Even if they're very intelligent and they're the geometric brain, they're there and that staid symbol. They can handle they can handle it. But when we're dealing with the algebra brain, they're like, well, there are other facets. And so you're like, well, okay, I think I get you. I think I understand there are other facets. They might say that to you, but they may never understand. You can tell them those other facets, but I swear they may never understand. So that's really kind of like an odd, isn't it? That some brains are just built differently. You know, that there is never going to be that clarity. They will never, ever understand the fullness factor, the depths, the undertone. They will never actually go further into the philosophy of the state of the mathematic mind. You know, they don't want to go further past that. They just want to talk about the mathematic mind as that's it. There's A, B, and C. A, B, and C. And it's like no, there's more to life than the A, B, and C. Yeah, abstraction begins to exist. Abstracts. So when we're dealing with abstraction, oh my goodness. We start to weave in the creative mind. I believe a lot of creativity exists past the algebra mind. I believe huge amounts of creativity. Kind of like a faucet that just can't ever turn off. Just endless. So yeah. Sadly, I believe a lot of people have algebra minds, but they may be damned by them, by other people. The arithmetic mind and the geometric mind may be flouncing them in, not flouncing them, but yeah, flogging them for existing in their conceptualism. You know, that they're dealing with a different state of being in life. You know, they want to be conceptualizers. You know, this concept and that concept and this discussion and that discussion. And they have all of this input here and this one here. And I'm like, oh my gosh, these people are creator idea people. Hello, hello, hello. I love that. And then yet, these other groupies, the groupies of the original arithmetic, only knowing A, B, and C, gosh dang it. Yeah, they do hurt. They do hurt the algebraic mind group. Yeah, I'd really like to go further past that with philosophy. Yeah, brings in a lot of things. We're talking about space and time. Not just your energy spent to the time card to continuum. We're talking about space and time. And controlling that. Controlling space and time. Removing it, interrupting it, shrinking it, expanding it. When I get into that word control. Did you have an endless day? Did you have one of those days? How far did your day go? You know what I'm saying? Was it like a day that was 20 hours long when it was only 7? How far? So, conceptual mind thinkers, yeah, you are the poets, you are the authors, you are the singers, songwriters. I won't say you're the singers, I will say you're the songwriters. Yeah, pen to paper people, pencil, ink, whatever, typing keypads or whatever. Conceptualism. Yeah, I don't know. I'm kind of tired. I guess I'll talk about that another time.